Hello everyone, welcome to Analog IAS current affair analysis for 21st September 2020 and these are the articles we'll be dealing today. The first article for the day is taken from the Hindu and it is titled Define the Contours of Hate in Speech. This is regarding the need for a clear legislation on the aspect of hate speech. So what is hate speech? What qualifies as a hate speech? And what are the legislations associated with this? Why hate speech is a threat to the freedom of speech and expression as recognized in the Article 19. These are the aspects that we'll be talking about in this article. Now to begin with, we know that Article 19 of our Constitution has guaranteed us the freedom of speech and expression. But there should be a border or a threshold to which one can have this right, because you're not free to talk whatever we want, and there is a public order and morality clause in the Constitution itself to put a restriction on the free speech of an individual or a group. Now the case that we're talking about pertains to a news channel called Sudarshan News. So this channel started airing a series of articles wherein it tried to vilify Muslims. It alleged that the Muslims started a jihadist campaign to infiltrate the civil services and even went to the extent of quoting false information. So this has caused a lot of resentment amongst the circles of the media as well as the citizens, because this has publicly targeted one community in our country. This has potentially had the impact of creating either fear or hatred or resentment towards Muslims. So therefore, it has every parameter to be adjudged as hate speech. Now, what is hate speech? Hate speech can be defined as incitement to hatred against a particular group of persons. They can be marginalized by their religious belief, sexual orientation, gender, or any other factor. So we have had instances where certain leaders like Asaduddin Owaisi, Varun Gandhi, who resorted to this hate speech during elections. So this hate speech is a threat to the freedom of expression, and also it has the potential to disturb the peace and moral order that is existing in the society. In this context, the Law Commission of India has created a new law in the form of Criminal Law Amendment in 2017. So as a part of this, the commission in 267th report on hate speech said such utterances have the potential to provoke individuals and society to commit acts of terrorism, genocide and ethnic cleansing. So as a part of this, the Law Commission suggested that there shall be a section 153C of the IPC which penalizes incitement to hatred. However, there are various other laws and there is a lot of confusion associated with this idea of hate speech. The reason being, they are very vaguely defined. So the author tries to quote certain examples in this article to describe what constitutes a hate speech and what does not constitute a hate speech. In this article, the writer uses the example of criticizing the tenets of Buddhism. So if a person wants to criticize Buddhist principles, he is free to do so. That is not hate speech. But if the same person tries to say that every follower of Buddhism is immoral, then he is trying to stereotype a particular group based on their religious beliefs. That qualifies as hate speech. Similarly, another example would be if a writer or if a artist or any person wants to create a parody or a satire on a certain religious figure which has the potential to outrage the sentiments of its followers, then he is not subject to hate speech. But if the same person tries to typecast the entire community or a follower of a religious sect as anti-national, then he is resorting to hate speech. So this sort of bifurcation and a clarity on the definition of hate speech and what constitutes a hate speech should be legally defined. And even though there were attempts that were made in the Indian Penal Code through section 153C and another section 295A of the Indian Penal Code, they are very vaguely defined. So in this context, the author suggests a solution in the form of prior restraint. What is this prior restraint? Say for example, if the Supreme Court comes up with a set of guidelines which define what qualifies for a hate speech as discussed in the prior examples, and come up with a set of rules for the broadcasters as well that would not violate the freedom of speech and expression, the onus is on the media and the channels that are broadcasting this sort of news to ensure that they exercise a prior restraint. That is, they have to check whether they are violating the guidelines given by the Supreme Court. That can ensure that they don't telecast this kind of hate speeches in the form of TV programs. That is the gist of this article. So this article takes off from the point where we have left the other day, making sense of the farm bills. So the three ordinances which were passed as a part of the Atmanirbhar package finally became acts. So what are the acts that are passed right now? The first one is the APMC Amendment Act, or the act which allows a farmer to sell his produce outside even the agricultural mandis. So what it allows is basically a free market economy in agricultural markets. The biggest concern is, take a look at this chart. Marginal farmers, that is the people who have less than 1 hectare, have been increasing over the past 30 years and 40 years. In fact, in the last 5 decades, the amount of operational holdings which can be categorized under the marginal farming, or the marginal farmer, that is the person having less than 1 hectare, has increased many times. So what this essentially does in a free market economy is, they don't have the required bargaining power to deal with the corporates. Now if you are having a mandi system wherein you can hold the government accountable during election process, it allows for the farmer to have some sort of a leverage. But if he is actually manipulated by corporates, he would not have any sort of bargaining power. So that is the first concern raised by the farmer, which is very valid. Now to clear this, what we are essentially doing is creating opportunities for the free market economy. That is, he can sell his produce outside the markets as well. But it doesn't mean that we are dismantling the MSP system completely. The government has given an assurance that MSP system will be here to stay. The argument by the government is, since 1991, when LPG reform started in our country, almost every sector reaped the benefits of liberalization except the farming sector. Why not the farmers? Why shouldn't a farmer leverage the private deal? That is the question raised. But farmers also have their own reasons to be wary of this market economy in agriculture. The one example that we can talk about is the kind of export ban that was enforced last year when the onion prices were skyrocketing. So there was a ban on exports. So in a debate between the farmers and consumers, the government has picked the side of consumers. So this is the sort of attitude the government has always taken. It has never been pro-farmer. So what if the government fails to contain the greed of corporates? That is the fear expressed by the small and marginal farmers. Secondly, when we're talking about a free market economy, one should be equipped with the right kind of information to decide the price for that. So a price discovery is a factor of information, and farmers don't have that kind of information to decide the price of their product. Say for example, in a geographical entity, all the farmers produced a single crop, tomato. What happens as a result is the price crashes. So in order to have a predictive analytics system in place to decide the price of that crop, the farmer should be empowered. Now that is absent. If you are not creating the necessary infrastructure for price discovery, that is information portal for deciding the optics of what will be the kind of produce this year, how will the farmer decide the price? That is the question raised. The next question raised by the farmer is, if we don't have the kind of infrastructure needed for supporting a free market economy, how do you expect the farmer to raise money for renting out this infrastructure in cold chains and warehouses? That is very expensive. So in such absence of infrastructure, it is obvious that the private player will try to manipulate the farmer, and this will even further deteriorate his condition. So if you take a look at all this, there are two ways to look at this. One is to understand the concerns of the farmer, and the other one is to understand the vision of the government. So the vision of the government is indeed noble. It is to empower the farmer and put the balance in favor of the farmer instead of the consumer. So at the same time, the concerns expressed by these farmers' unions are very legitimate. It is indeed required to create the kind of information infrastructure and also the physical infrastructure for a better price discovery and efficient functioning of the markets. And given the fact that 86% of the land holdings are marginal, that is less than 1 hectare, it is definitely needed to have a sort of a mechanism that facilitates mainstreaming of farmer produce organizations to ensure that they have a collective market bargaining power. Unless and until all these things fall in place, the vision of the government to create an economy that facilitates doubling of farmers' income is not going to be viable, at least in the near future. So the government must address all these concerns as soon as possible. That is the gist of this article.